We can start the last talk of today's session. Professor Boris Kesin will speak about Hamiltonian geometry and dynamics behind the compressible fluids.
Thank you. First of all, let me thank the organizers for inviting me here. It's a pleasure to be here. I would like to give a chalkboard talk because that's what we are here for. In a sense, such a pleasure to be here in person. So what I would like to talk about is the Hamiltonian geometry and dynamics, which is responsible not only for incompressible fluids, but for fluids that allow some compression or even discontinuities. So this, what I'm going to talk about is our joint work with Gerard Misiolik and Klaus Madin. And most of what I'm going to talk about is in our paper that was recently published in BAMS. But let me start with Arnold's picture for incompressible Euler equation. So it's maybe not directly related to the topic of this workshop, but there will be a lot of Hamiltonian structures later on, and one can always pose a question to find some cluster structures there, so why not? So I would like to just recall what Arnold's formulation of the Euler equation is, and so I'm not stating for the Euler equation for an ideal incompressible fluid. So for this, let's start with some Riemannian manifold that I will call M. So with some Riemannian metric. And as an example, we can think of a domain in n-dimensional space, possibly with boundary. And we assume that this field is an ideal incompressible fluid. So all fluid particles just move somehow. And we will describe the motion by means of the velocity field. So V will be the velocity field. Oh, it will be changing in time. Yeah, so V will depend on the point X of the manifold and also on time. Since I'm talking about incompressible fluid, I assume that there exists some volume form that I will denote by mu on this manifold, and fluids preserve this volume form. The fluid motions preserve this volume form. It could be related to the Riemannian volume or could be different, it doesn't matter. Then the Euler equations for the motion of such a fluid are evolution equations on the velocity field V. So they are given by the following system of two equations. But the main one is regard the first equation. So the time derivative of V plus the covariant derivative of V along itself is equal to minus gradient of a function, which is the what's called the pressure function, which is find uniquely up to an additive constant by an extra condition that V is a divergence free vector field. So very often this second equation is assumed, and then it's just called Euler equation rather than Euler equations. If the manifold has boundary, then this has to be supplemented by the condition that V is tangent to the boundary. Then Arnold's contribution in the middle. Yes. So if you just put the divergence on both sides of this equation, then you will get the elliptic equation on P. It will be so essentially the velocity field is incompressible at every moment, and if you just put divergence, there will be no this term, and the Laplacian of P will be some covariant derivative of V length itself, and this will give the condition on P up to a negative constant, thanks to the boundary conditions as well. So now,
it depends
not
locally on
V. It depends on locally on V. Yeah. That's right. So theorem due to Vladimir Arnold, and that was published in his famous 1966 paper, is that the Euler equation of an ideal incompressible fluid filling the domain M can be regarded as the equation of the geodesic flow on an infinite dimensional manifold. This manifold, so this is the geodesic equation on the following manifold, which is actually a group. And the group is the group of volume preserving diffeomorphisms of the manifold M. So these are all smooth diffeomorphisms which preserve the volume form mu on the manifold. But once I said that what the manifold is, I also have to specify what the metric is, because it is a geodesic equation. So these are volume preserving diffeomorphisms of M. And this will be with respect to the right invariant L2 energy metric that is given by just the square of the L2 norm of the velocity field. So it is the integral over M of V inner product with itself, integrated with the help of the area form mu, and we take 1/2 of that. So what is going on here is the following. This. So the picture is as follows. So we have a group G, which will be the group of all volume preserving diffeomorphisms of the manifold M. And its identity, the identity diffeomorphism, let's consider the corresponding Lie algebra. So it will be the tangent space to the group. So G will consist of all divergence free vector fields on M. And now on this vector fields, we'll define the quadratic form, which is the energy quadratic form. So now we can measure the length of every vector. So this is a quadratic form. So I just write it schematically like this. This is a kind of unit ball. And after that, once we can measure length of every vector here, we can do the same at every tangent space to the group. Namely, we just right transport the metric, this quadratic form to this very point. Now we have a quadratic form at every tangent plane, which means that we have actually Riemannian metric. This is actually weak Riemannian, but let's kind of think of geometry only at this point. Now it makes sense to consider the geodesic with respect to this metric. So this will be a geodesic with respect to this right invariant metric on the group. Now we'll do the following. So I start with some velocity vector V, and then I send the geodesic, and at each moment, at each time along this geodesic, I just take the corresponding velocity vector and pull this back to the identity. It will not necessarily be the original vector. It would be if it were a one parameter subgroup, but in general, it's not. It's not a bi-invariant metric, so it's just one-sided invariant. So it will be changing in time. And this evolution equation, how V changes, is nothing but the Euler equation that is written here. So this is Arnold's approach. And now the remark is that it turned out that this approach turned out to be extremely general. And as a matter of fact, one can consider, so we have essentially two ingredients involved. Namely, we have to choose a group that we start with, and we have to choose the quadratic form, the energy quadratic form to define the corresponding metric. And after that, we can just repeat the same procedure. So if we take other pairs of the group G and the energy, then they lead to a huge variety of different equations. As a matter of fact, over the years, there were many other equations. And I will just mention some of them here. So for instance, the Kirchhoff equations for a rigid body in a fluid, that's the equations of the Burgers equation that I'm actually going to discuss a little bit later today. So I'll just mention it here. So it's for freely flying particles. The Carter de Vries equation. Yes.
I'm sorry. Is it possible to write down the general form of the equation is for any group and quadratic form? So I guess it's some universal form of the equation.
I can write this equation in kind of the roundabout way by taking the dual space here and writing this equation as a Hamiltonian equation in the dual space. Then
you have identification of the dual space because you have Riemannian metric.
So the identification is by means of what's called the inertia operator I, which actually is, so the energy would be one half of VIV. So yeah. I will define the quadratic form. And then the this very equation that is kind of in this language would be dtv is some nonlinear operator b, whatever it means, in the dual language here will mean the following. So if m is the image of the of our velocity in the dual space, then it will be here the equation will be as follows. So we'll just write it for m, the Euler equation is dtm,
so the momentum now
is I inverse of m applied to m. Sorry, it's a bit busy here. You have a question?
Yeah, I have a question. To start, I guess, because you start with this velocity field, and I mean, I guess first of all, when you're trying to think about the tangent vector there, I guess you're identifying the Lie algebra with vector fields. But I mean, first of all, the Lie algebra of all the diffeomorphisms be vector fields. But how do I know that it's going to be volume preserving?
So these are volume preserving diffeomorphisms. So these are divergence free vector fields.
Okay, that's part I understand.
So maybe I don't know. You know this by G mu.
Okay. I was just trying to understand the construction exactly. So you take, what would you do? You take that tangent vector, and then you.
So I start, the starting point is the velocity vector.
Yes.
It's just one vector, the identity. And then I send the geodesic with respect to the Riemannian metric that I had. It is a geodesic with a given velocity vector at the identity.
Okay.
So if it were a bi-invariant metric, it would be a one parameter subgroup. Mm-hmm. And then there would be nothing interesting as a matter of fact. So, in this metric, it will be some trajectory. So I take velocity vector along this trajectory, pull this back to the identity by means of again the right translation. It was a right invariant metric, so I use again the right translation back there. If it were left invariant metric, it would be left translation. There are different choices here. And then I have an evolution. So the advantage of this is that I have the evolution not in the group but in the Lie algebra where I have kind of the linear structure. That's why we can write the corresponding equation in terms of velocities. Of course, this is what's called the Eulerian representation. It's not the Lagrangian representation where I would have the evolution of every fluid particle. Here, I have just evolution of the velocity field. In some sense, I yet have to integrate the corresponding velocity field to get the particle. Okay, and this is the equation in the Hamiltonian form, but one can rewrite this in purely Riemannian terms here, and this is exactly Arnold's approach to the Euler equation. So again, as I mentioned, there are many, many equations here, so I'll just write. So KdV equation, magnetohydrodynamics can be described in a similar way, and so on. So there are many choices here. Yeah, that is not a kind of a universal point of view, but it does cover a lot. Yes.
About the pressure, or I mean, where is the pressure hidden in other approach? You just set pressure to zero, or is...
It will be clear later. Ah, okay. I'll come to it. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Now, compressible fluids. So this was an, a nice description for incompressible fluid. For compressible, there are some difficulties. So compressible fluid also has a description, but let me kind of start it kind of backwards. So I'll start this again with the equation. And so it is also called the oil equation. And for a barotropic fluid, has the following form. I'll explain the word barotropic in a second. So again, you have a system of two equations. First is the equation on the velocity of the fluid. It is, again, the material derivative. So these two terms together, they form the material derivative of so it's the time derivative of V plus the covariant derivative of V along itself. And it is equal to the gradient term. So 1/rho, where rho is the density of the fluid times pressure, which now depends on the density of the fluid. So so here, so for a fluid velocity V, and density rho. And rho itself is changing according to the continuity equation. So the time derivative of rho plus the divergence of V rho, or better say rho V, is equal to zero. So now this is the equation in which the density, the pressure term depends on density only. So that's why it is called a barotropic fluid. And if it is the most general fluid, then it would be also depending on entropy, and then there would be a corresponding equation for entropy.
But you need to specify the factor of your problem.
Yes. So this the way how it depends on fluid is called the equation of state, and it's related to the internal energy of the fluid. So and it has this form where E of rho is what's called the internal energy of the fluid. So it depends, for instance, of whether it is a one atomic gas, diatomic gas, and so on. So these are different ways of the different relations of how internal energy is depending on the density. And then there was a theorem by Smolentsev. Yes.
I did not answer my question. So this function E prime of rho, you need to specify.
Yes, right? Yeah, you do specify it a priori. And then it is a very specific way of how pressure depends on density. And there it was defined by the fluid itself. So there rho is identically equal to one. So, but here we do specify this. And the theorem that was kind of overlooked for a while, so it's, proved by Smolentsev back in 1979, is that essentially based on the Arnold's approach, is that the Euler equation for a barotropic fluid, or the Euler barotropic equation or equations, are not the geodesic equations as before, but they are Newton equations. So this is the Newton equation. On the group of diffeomorphisms of M, now we consider all diffeomorphisms, not necessarily incompressible, but the Lagrangian now, so it used to be just the kinetic energy, just because it was a geodesic, but now we'll add the potential energy to this Lagrangian. So it is kinetic minus potential energy for the potential, which is related to this pressure for the potential U of rho, which is the integral over M of this internal energy, E of rho times rho mu. Mu is some reference density to start with. So we kind of write the Newton equations, or for instance, the Hamiltonian equations for the Hamiltonian, which is now the sum of kinetic and potential, and the corresponding equations will be a pair of equations, one of them describing velocity and the other describing the density. So Smolensov himself tried to rewrite it completely in terms of geodesics, similar to Arnold's approach, and then it kind of one needs to use this Maupertuis principle. But this, in my opinion, is kind of a cleaner description, just a Newton equation related to density. Yeah, this is E prime. It's a derivative of E with respect to this one variable. It is a function of one variable. Yeah. No, no, this is only diffeomorphisms of M. Yeah, so bear with me for a little while. Now I will describe kind of the general picture where you will see both these approaches together. Okay.
What are the variables? V and rho together, right?
Right.
So V lives in people M.
Just bear with me. Now, so I would like to relate to the geometry of diffeomorphisms and relate it kind of to describe these pictures that I kind of sketched for now and related also to optimal mass transport. So, so let's now consider this picture in kind of in a rotated way, so to say. So what I mean by that is the following. So let's consider the diffeomorphisms, or volume preserving diffeomorphisms, as a subgroup sitting in all diffeomorphisms of M. So now all diffeomorphisms I will regard as the total space of a fiber bundle over the space of densities. So these are densities, or in other words, volume forms on the manifold, smooth volume forms that are all normalized by the condition that the integral over the manifold is equal to one. So the picture to have in mind is as follows. So we have the group of all diffeomorphisms. So I always mean that diffeomorphisms of M, even if I don't write it. Now they are fibered over densities of M. And mu will be just one of the densities here, so a very specific point in the space of all densities, a reference one. Now, the fiber over this point mu will be the subgroup of volume preserving diffeomorphisms, those that are preserving this specific volume form mu. So this is, maybe I'll just write it here. So diffeomorphisms of mu. I will also take any other density, let's say nu.
Are you getting just a groupoid of densities?
No, it's just it's just the space on which the diffeomorphisms act.
No, but here you have some starting point mu, right?
Yeah.
And then if you get rid of the starting point,
it's like the base of the group. If
yes,
you want.
Yes, yeah, so the base of the groupoid will be densities.
That's right.
and that's the right. Errors will be transformation one density into another density.
That's right. Yeah. So I'm coming to that. Yeah. So what is the fiber over nu? It will not be the group of diffeomorphisms preserving nu, because we would like to have the fiber bundle, and of course identity will be only here. This is the identity. So the fiber here, I'll denote it by f nu, will be, so it will consist of all diffeomorphisms of the manifold M which move one density, namely this reference density mu, to nu. So this is just the space of cassettes, and it's clear that it is a transitive action on the space of densities, just because of the Moser theorem. All we need is just the total mass equal to one. So these are right cassettes, kind of are that where diffeomorphisms of mu will be the original subgroup that we start with. Now, I would like, so this is kind of the very natural picture. Now I would like to put some metric here. So the metric will be as follows. I will think of the L2 metric on the space of diffeomorphisms. On the space of all diffeomorphisms. And I'll just write this that for a flat manifold M. So suppose that this is, for instance, Rn or the torus, it is kind of the most natural metric you can think of. So think of this diffeomorphism G is just a map from Rn to Rn, and then we just take its L2 norm. So it's kind of regarded as the pre-Hilbert space of all vector functions on Rn. So in other words, if I would like to take a path here, which I denote by G, which is parameterized by some time, then the length of this path, the square of the length, will be by definition the following integral. I'll just take the time derivative of G, take its square of the L2 norm, and then integrate with respect to T. So it's kind of the flat metric that we can imagine. So it's just here. I'm thinking of the group of diffeomorphisms as a flat space. Now, theorem. Let's look here. Just thinking. Probably. A theorem proven by Felix Otte in 2000 is as follows. So if I take this group of all diffeomorphisms equipped with this L2 metric, so there exists an extension of that for any curved manifold M, but I will not give this formulas, and project it to the space of densities equipped with a certain metric that I'm about to write. And this metric is called Kantorovich-Weissenstein metric. And this is a Riemannian submersion. So now what is this metric? So instead I will write the distance function that is induced by this metric. As a matter of fact, it has the Riemannian origin. Namely, I would like to describe what is the distance with respect to this metric between two different densities, mu and nu. And as a matter of fact, this is kind of the most natural metric that appears in the optimal mass transport. And it is as follows. So suppose that I have two densities mu and nu on the same manifold M. And I would like to move one of them to the other. So what I do for that is just I take any point X and so apply diffeomorphism G. And for a given point X, I will look at its image G of X. But I would like them to move in the kind of shortest possible way. So I will take the distance between the point and its image, take the square of that, and on the manifold M. And then I integrate this over, so I average this over all possible points X on the manifold. And so this is how far the diffeomorphism G acts. And now I take the infinium over all diffeomorphisms G, which do the job. So such that G star mu is nu. And I said that this is the distance between two densities, mu and nu. So it turns out that, first of all, this distance function has the Riemannian origin, and it is defined in this way. So it is just Riemannian submersion. Riemannian submersion, by definition, means that I have the metric here, and I have the fibers. So there are vertical spaces, but then there exists a notion of a horizontal space. So at each point, there exists a horizontal space, which is orthogonal to the fiber. And then this Riemannian submersion, it maps isometrically this horizontal space to the tangent space on the base. Okay, now this is what's called the Kantorowicz-Wasserstein distance. Now, a couple of remarks. So, first of all, it turns out that geodesics with respect to this metric that I described over here, kind of easy to, it's easy to write equations for them. Namely, this is the Hilbert space, so the geodesics will be just straight lines. So in other words, the acceleration must be equal to zero. So geodesics on diffeomorphisms, by definition are given by the condition that if we introduce the velocity field, then it is the equation that the acceleration must be equal to zero. But if you now rewrite, you just put an extra derivative here, you will see that it is equivalent to the equation that dt v plus nabla v is equal to zero. So you recognize that this equation reminds you the Euler equation, except for it has zero pressure. So as a matter of fact, this is what's called the Burgers equation. And it describes just freely flying particles, non-interacting particles. So each particle just moves along its own geodesic on the manifold M, or along a straight line if it is in Rn. So in particular, for instance, when particles start colliding, this is exactly how shock waves are emerging. So that's one thing. Second, is the incompressible Euler equation, is obtained in the following way. I would like now to restrict this metric to the vertical space, this very metric restricted here. It turns out that this will be exactly the right invariant metric introduced by Arnoid there, because the metric that I introduced here is invariant with respect to volume preserving diffeomorphisms. For an arbitrary diffeomorphism, there would be Jacobian coming in here, but for volume preserving Jacobian is identically equal to one. So this is exactly the metric or right invariant metric on the fiber. It is now the right hand side can be regarded as the reaction force, which actually keeps the geodesic on the fiber itself. Otherwise, it would just fly off. So the incompressible Euler is just the restriction of the L2 metric to volume preserving diffeomorphisms, and one has dynamics in the fiber. Now the furthermore, now one can so one can now consider geodesics in the fiber, geodesics on the base. Furthermore, one can consider the function on the base here, which will be a potential. So this will be a potential function that can be lifted to be a function on the group of all diffeomorphisms. And then we regard this very, and then this allows us to consider Lagrangian, which is the kinetic energy plus potential. Now it is just in the same way as Newton equation is considered for a potential on a line. It will be a function on the line and the kinetic energy, and then we write the corresponding Newton equation as the second order equation there. Or one can rewrite it as the first order equation in the extended coordinates. So in the same way, it turns out that the equations of the compressible flow will be just equations of the Newton equation on this bigger group with the potential lifted from the base. So potential is defined as a function here, U of rho. Rho of nu. Yes. This is just the density here.
So nu is rho times mu.
Yes. Yeah. So, yeah. And then we just lift it here, and now it is a function on the base, of course, constant along the fibers. And then we write the corresponding equation. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And of particular interest are what's called potential solutions if the initial velocity will be horizontal. So the vertical velocities are divergence free, as we just discussed. So these are volume preserving diffeomorphisms, and the corresponding vector fields will be divergence free. But the, according to Koch decomposition, the corresponding potential solutions will correspond to the some potential function. And this is usually what's considered in the theory of Burgers equation and in the description of shock waves and so on. Now what does it have to do with what is yet another point of view on compressible fluid? And now I would like to kind of slightly change the perspective. And so we came to understanding that one can consider either equations here. So okay, we started, let's just kind of read up to summarize. So we started with the Arnold approach to ideal the flows of an ideal fluid on the fibers here. Now we can consider kind of this larger picture with geodesics on the whole group of diffeomorphisms, and in particular we can look at the corresponding Newton equations for arbitrary potentials. So these are second order equations on the group of all diffeomorphisms. If you look at the horizontal geodesics, then due to the property that this is a Riemannian submersion, any geodesic on the base can be lifted uniquely to a geodesic, the horizontal geodesic in this group with a given initial point. Of course, I mean, there are many horizontal geodesics, depends on where I started, but if I, for instance, started the identity, then it is just a unique lift of the corresponding geodesic. So this way is kind of a very natural way to write the equations of the geodesic on the base. And this is exactly what people in doing optimal mass transport are mostly interested in, to write the shortest way to move one density to the other in the most economical way. So this is a geodesic, and now we just see that it is in some sense just the horizontal geodesic of a compressible oil equation with zero potential. Now, in particular, if we confine ourselves only to potential solutions, we can forget about diffeomorphisms and think only about density space, because everything can be uniquely lifted here to horizontal geodesics. So I would like to discuss now this very space and give yet one more point of view on this. Okay. For this, I have to recall what is called the Madelung transform. So this is the theorem that is proved by Madelung in 1927, and some version of that by von Renesse in 2012. I'll say which ones. That there exists the what's called a hydrodynamical form of quantum mechanics. Namely, if you think of quantum mechanics as the following nonlinear Schrödinger equation, so I dt, so written on a wave function psi on a manifold M, plus Laplacian of psi plus, okay, I'll write it in the most nonlinear form, f of psi squared. C and plus the potential, which depends on x times C. So there exists a transform of this equation into the following system of two equations. Now we will recognize some terms that we had before, plus two gradient of okay, I will explain the notations in a second. And the continuity equation as usual. So let me just write it down. So we have two equations on a velocity field V and on the density rho. So I put here something in the square brackets, meaning that I can actually take out this term and keep only the linear terms in this equation. So this will be the linear Schrödinger equation. And then respectively, I'll just take out this part, which is in the brackets, and it will be the velocity, the equation on the velocity without this function F. Where V is the Nabla X on the whole thing, yeah, on both of them. And velocity is assumed to be the gradient of a function. So it's not just an arbitrary velocity, but only the potential one that we discussed there. And C is just can be written in the polar form, so to say, where rho plays the role of the amplitude and theta plays the role of the argument. So let's discuss this a little bit. What?
Square root is all the rho.
The square root is for everything, yeah. Yeah, there are two different ways to write it. Of course, I mean, they differ just by a factor two. Yeah, but this is correct. Okay, so this is a Schrödinger equation that appeared in print actually in the same year. It was submitted essentially in 1926. So it was almost simultaneously with the Schrödinger equation. Madelung suggested its hydrodynamical form. Now you can see why it's called hydrodynamical form. If you just simply rewrite the wave function in terms of, in some sense, in polar coordinates and by rho and theta, then it turns out that the corresponding evolution equation on the wave function becomes a pair of evolution equations. For rho, it will be just exactly the continuity equation, so it behaves like the density, while the velocity field will be just the gradient of the corresponding argument. So that is, yeah, and essentially a middle long this in the linear form, and Renessa, I think, added this nonlinear part, but maybe it was before. Yeah. He learned, it was not kind of independent. Yeah. He learned from Schwenger, but surprisingly, it was, I mean, the very fast publication. So you could really see it the same very year in December issue, there was already this equation, it appeared. And now I would like to kind of elaborate a little bit on why it is interesting from the geometric point of view. You can, of course, see that this equation is very much like a compressible fluid equation that is here. It's called nonetheless quantum fluid, just because it is assumed that the pressure here depends on density only, but here derivatives of densities are involved. And that's kind of an unusual thing for a barotropic fluid. That's why it's called a quantum fluid or quantum pressure. So what is the geometry? So the question that I would like to address is the geometry behind. And for this, I would like to kind of massage this very formula a little bit. Namely, maybe I'll just write here somewhere. So for this, let me give the following definition. I will define the Madelung transform here is the map from a pair rho and theta to so both of them are real valued functions on M to a complex valued function on M again, that is the square root of rho e to the I theta. But before I'll do that, I would like to adjust a little bit these two functions, rho and theta. So what are the conditions or assumptions on them rather? So first of all, remember that I would like to have a normalized density. So it's first of all, it is of course everywhere positive. I'm thinking of this depending on so rho times mu, if you want. So it's normalized so that the integral over the whole manifold M is equal to one. As far as theta is concerned, I would like to, since eventually I will be using only the gradient of theta, it means that theta can be defined up to a relative constant. And that's why I will denote this by this cassette of theta. So this will be just theta plus a constant C for an arbitrary real C. So yes.
If you go to psi, it's only defined up to 2 pi multiples. So you take this into account somehow?
It will define up to just any constant anyway. So that's why I don't care. Yeah, in principle, yeah, I would have to do it over there, but that's why I would like to massage the data a little bit. So I actually. So, okay. So, but I also will massage psi a little bit. Namely, we will look at some cassettes of psi. Namely, first of all, I would like to assume that psi is no way zero on M, and also, I would like it to be the unit length. So if, its square will be equal to one. I mean, the integral that is L to norm over the manifold M. And moreover, it is defined up to an argument, a constant argument. So it's the psi will be C times e to the I alpha for any constant alpha. So I identify all psi that differ only by multiplication by changing the phase. Then note the following, that such a pair, rho and the class of theta, as a matter of fact, can be regarded as an element of the cotangent space to densities. Let's see why. Just because densities, so the space of densities is normalized by the condition is in a fine space that rho is equal to one. So it means that the tangent vector will be a volume form which integrates to zero. And then the dual space will be the space of functions defined up to a constant. But that's exactly what theta is. So that's why one can think of this pair rho and theta as an element of the cotangent space. Similarly, we can think of psi in the following way. So first of all, I put psi on the unit sphere. Psi originally belongs to a vector space of all wave functions. But then we specify that it is on the unit sphere. And then I have the circle action on the sphere. So as a matter of fact, this is an element of the projective space, of infinite dimensional projective space of, yes, you're way ahead of me. Of non-zero functions. And we got this map. So the Madelung transform actually maps the cotangent bundle to densities to the projective infinite dimensional space of all wave functions on M. Now, theorem is that, is that it turns out that phi, which is working this way, so it's from T star dense and equipped with the canonical symplectic structure on the cotangent bundle to the projective space with the canonical symplectic structure, with the Fubini-Studi symplectic structure. Is a symplectomorphism. So it is actually the same space. So not only that we have the map of equations this way, but as a matter of fact, we have the whole structures that are mapped this way by means of the Madelung transform. And I will just very sketchy mention that in this picture that I gave here, this is well adapted for the optimal mass transport when we start with the L2 metric upstairs and get the Wasserstein, Kantorovich-Wasserstein metric downstairs. But as a matter of fact, one can start with a different metric, as we noticed Arnold's, for instance, formulation of the Euler equation. You change the metric and you get completely different equation. So in the same way, you can actually put H1 metric here, and it brings in some interesting insight. So in particular, H1 dot metric, that is just L2 metric on the derivatives, leads to what's called the Fischer-Rao metric on the space of densities. Yep. So it's from H1 dot metric, so the L2 metric on the derivatives, it just leads to Fischer-Rao metric here. And it turns out that if you in this theorem there exists a, it's kind of the Riemannian analog, namely the second statement here is that, so theorem two is that not only that it is a symplectomorphism, but as a matter of fact, if you define the Fischer-Rao metric on the space of densities, then it is an isometry to the Fubini-Studi metric on the projective space. So this is actually not only a symplectomorphism, but is a Keuler map. So I will just write this here. So F is an isometry between what's called the Sasaki-Fischer-Rao metric. on key start ends. It is related to H1 dot metric on density on diffeomorphisms. And the Fubini study. On the projective space. Yeah, it is Sobolev metric on the space of all diffeomorphisms. And I'll just stop here.